channel. In this video, we are going to see about anatomy of humerus. Humerus is a long bone. It is the bone of our arm. Like all other long bones, humerus is also divided into three parts. The end which is on the upper side is called as upper end. The end which is on the lower side is called as lower end. And the part of the bone which is in between these two ends is called as shaft of humerus. So now we are going to see about the upper end. Upper end is having a rounded part in its medial side. It is called as head of humerus. So the rounded part on the medial side of the humerus is called as head of humerus. And the upper end of humerus have two tubercles. They are lesser tubercle and greater tubercle. The tubercle which is lesser in size, we call it as lesser tubercle. The tubercle which is greater in size, we call it as greater tubercle. In between these two tubercles, there is a depressed area. This depressed region is called as intertubercular sulcus. Between these two tubercles, there is a depressed area. It is called as intertubercular sulcus. In the lower part of the intertubercular sulcus, it has two lips. The lip on the lateral side is called as lateral lip. And the lip on the medial side is called as medial lip. Medial lip is the continuation of lesser tubercle. And lateral lip is the continuation of greater tubercle. And the humerus have two necks. One is anatomical neck and another one is surgical neck. The anatomical neck is a line which separates the head of humerus from other parts of the upper end. The line which separates the head of humerus from other parts of the upper end is called as anatomical neck. So this is the line which separates the head of humerus from other parts of the upper end. So this is the anatomical neck of humerus. And the line which separates the upper end from the shaft is called as surgical neck. So this is the line that separates the upper end from the shaft of humerus. So this is the surgical neck of humerus. That's all for upper end. Moving on to the lower end, we can clearly see that upper end is rounded whereas lower end is flattened side to side. Upper end is rounded and lower end is flattened side to side. Coming to the lower end have two epicondyles. One is medial epicondyle and another one is lateral epicondyle. The epicondyle which is directly below the head is called as medial epicondyle. So the epicondyle which is directly below the head is called as medial epicondyle. And the epicondyle on the opposite side is called as lateral epicondyle. In addition to that point, medial epicondyle is larger and lateral epicondyle is smaller. So the epicondyle which is larger and which is on the side of the head of humerus is called as medial epicondyle. And the epicondyle which is smaller and opposite to the medial epicondyle is lateral epicondyle. Moving on to the articular part, we have two articular parts. The part which is on the medial side is called as trochlea and the part which is on the lateral side is called as capitulum. The trochlea part is going to articulate with the trochlear notch of ulna and the capitulum part is going to articulate with the radius bone, head of radius. And in this model bone, they have given it like there is a cut here. But actually, there is no cut here. Anatomically, there is no cut. So, there will be no cut in the original bone. So, just ignore the cut. The part which is on the medial side is trochlea. And the part which is on the lateral side is capitulum. Here is the ulna bone. And this is the trochlear notch of ulna. So the trochlear notch comes and articulate in the trochlear part of humerus like this. And here is the radius bone. This is the head of radius. The head of radius comes and articulates in the capitulum like this. And there are two depressed areas in the front of humerus. The one above the trochlea is called as coronoid fossa, and the one above the capitulum is called as radial fossa. The one which is above the trochlea is going to get accommodated by the coronoid process of ulna while we are flexing our elbow. So this is the coronoid process of ulna. Now this elbow is an extension. See, this elbow is an extension. While we are flexing our elbow, the coronoid process of ulna is getting accommodated in that coronoid fossa. As this fossa is getting accommodated by the coronoid process, we call it as coronoid fossa. And coming to the radial fossa, it is going to get accommodated by the head of radius while we are flexing our elbows. So this is the extension position of radius. While elbow flexion, the head of radius comes and getting accommodated in that fossa. So we call it as radial fossa. As this fossa is accommodated by the radial head, we call it as radial fossa. And this fossa is getting accommodated by the coronoid process of ulna, so we call it as coronoid fossa. And on the medial epicondyle, above the medial epicondyle, there is a line, we call it as medial supracondylar ridge. The same above the lateral epicondyle, we have a line, we call it as lateral supracondylar ridge. So this is the lateral supracondylar ridge and this is the medial supracondylar ridge. And coming to the posterior side, there is a big fossa, we call it as olecranon fossa. Because the olecranon process of ulna is going to get accommodated in that area. So this is the olecranon process of ulna. This elbow is in flexion now. While extending our elbows, the olecranon process of ulna is getting accommodated in that olecranon fossa. So as this fossa is accommodating the olecranon process of ulna, we call it as olecranon fossa. So that's all for lower end. Moving on to the shaft. The shaft of humerus have three borders and three surface. First we are going to see about the borders. The three borders are anterior border, medial border and posterior border. Anterior border starts from the greater tubercle and ends just above the coronoid fossa. So this is the coronoid fossa. Anterior border ends just above the coronoid fossa and it begins at the greater tubercle of humerus. So from the greater tubercle and ends at the coronoid fossa, just above the coronoid fossa. And coming to the medial border, it starts at the lesser tubercle and it passes medially and it ends in the medial supracondylar ridge. So it ends in the medial supracondylar ridge and it starts in the lesser tubercle. Starting from the lesser tubercle, it is passing medially and ending in the medial supracondylar ridge. So if we trace the medial supracondylar ridge above, we can find the medial border, which is going to end at the lesser tubercle. So moving on to the lateral border. Lateral border is not visible in its upper half. It is only visible in its lower half. The same as medial border, it is ending at the lateral supracondylar ridge. So while tracing the lateral supracondylar ridge above, we can find the lateral border up to his lower half. Up to its lower half, we can find it. So this is the lateral border of humerus. This is the anterior border. And this is the medial border. So moving on to the surface, we have three surfaces. One is anteromedial surface and another one is anterolateral surface and another one is posterior surface. The surface between the anterior border and the medial border is called as anteromedial surface, and the surface between the anterior border and the lateral border is called as anterolateral surface, and the surface between the medial and lateral border is called as posterior surface. So anteromedial surface, anterolateral surface and posterior surface. In the anteromedial surface, in its middle, there is a nutrient foramen. And on the anterolateral surface, in the middle, there is a V-shaped tuberosity. We call it as deltoid tuberosity because the deltoid muscle is going to get inserted in this tuberosity. So this is called as deltoid tuberosity because of the insertion of deltoid muscle. And on the posterior surface, we have two markings. The one is radial groove for the passage of radial nerve, and the one above the radial groove is called as oblique ridge. There is an oblique line above the radial groove, we call it as oblique ridge. So this is the oblique ridge and this is the groove for radial nerve. We call it as radial groove. So that's all for anatomy of humerus. Thank you.